All right, our next inductee earned his spot in the Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame for his reporting in sports. You know, ladies and gentlemen, Fred Kalil.
We begin here, some 40 years ago, at Indiana University. Look closely and you'll see the walk-on linebacker, number 31. This is Fred Kalil, an aspiring athlete who had deep inside of him and an innate love of sports.
You are watching Indiana's own Wish TV.
And journalism.
I'm just really happy to be back, and I thank everybody for their thoughts and prayers, and I especially this morning. school football.
Full recovery took years. On the air, he was 100%. But Chris Holcomb knew what Kalil was going through off the air. Holcomb had lost his sister to a brain tumor 14 years earlier.
And I was so impressed by his perseverance and his ethic of working so hard to battle that and to get beyond that, which he has done very successfully. And then also not only doing that for himself, but then working for other people.
The Guardian kept pitching over the hill.
Kalil, using his platform to help athletes and everyone else understand the many causes and preventions of brain injury and brain tumors, working with patients and foundations to raise awareness and research funds. Now sports director at Atlanta's WGCL CBS 46 and living his dream, this once aspiring athlete with a lifelong love of sports and journalism and people, pursuing his journey with the heart of a champion. Fred Kalil, 2017 inductee, Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
Those promos are priceless, aren't they? Not as priceless as you, Fred. I want to introduce to you CEO of the Atlanta Falcons, Rich McKay.
Really won't succeed, just too nice a guy. Well, I don't know, that nice guy ended up winning a Super Bowl and getting into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And I think when you look at Fred and you realize what Fred is, all Fred is he's really good at what he does, and he's a really good guy. So it's my pleasure to introduce Fred Kalil into the Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
Sports at 550, and Mike Sagel was our photographer.
and we're doing it. I'm getting ready to go, oh yeah, let's talk about the Braves, and he's going. I'm going, what are you talking about, man? Put the camera on me. And he goes, the stadium had caught fire. But I mean, it was just starting to burn a little bit. There was just a stadium fire. This was 10 of 6, okay? And, this, and we were the first ones on the air. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, Coach McVay over there, Tim McVay, now the general manager of Channel 2, we were teammates. He was my graduate assistant coach. I think Channel 2 might have peeled our signal off a little bit that time. We just happened to be on. I heard those bullets. We just happened to be on the air. And all of a sudden, you know, Zagel's pointing to it, and the stadium's on fire. I'm thinking, holy crap, here we go. So I said, you know, you can see the little fire out there, we're talking. You know, all of a sudden, Ted Turner walks in the middle of this. Now it's like 6:30, and the thing is way up in flames, right? Ted Turner walks in, I've got Ted Turner on. I said, Ted, you know what? They're bringing fire trucks in. He goes, ah, hell, I don't know how they're bringing fire trucks in here, but there's a lot of water in the Mississippi. Maybe we get some of that over here. Well, the story that you don't know, that was when the flood ravaged Mississippi, went over into Missouri and St. Louis and was wiping it out. Attaboy, Ted, you never knew what you were going to do. But, you know, you talk about the teams over the years, but, you know, are we ever going to see Lavin, Maddox, and Smoltz again? I mean, you see three guys going to the Hall of Fame. I got to see Lenny Book has become the NBA's all-time winningest coach. The dream team, you know, back in 96, you know, we were on live, and Roger can remember this. You know, we were the NBC affiliate, we were on live, and, you know, Jordan, Ewing, all these guys, they're just coming off the court, coming over, talking to us. They were having a blast here in Atlanta. I mean, you know, Bobby Kremers, the Georgia Tech coach, who's, you know, Bobby's a goofball, and he's Lenny's assistant coach, and he's there at the Olympics, and he was a great guy to have on the air as well. And I did Bobby's show for a while, too, and as Bobby Kremers would say, welcome to the show. Fred, I'd like to welcome Fred Kalil. Fred, where do you work? Thank you, Bobby. Thank you. Oh, yeah. Now, people remember Friedman, right? But you might not remember Frednik. Frednik was always the day after Friedman. Okay? And we got in trouble because we parked right outside the channel. Channel 2 and Channel Memphis is right next to each other. I parked right outside of it. We parked out there I had my trunk open. I had Steve Holman, the voice of the Hawks, in the trunk, okay, with his hand on sideways. Doing yo, yo, yo. I mean, if that shit was bad, I was out of the sunroof. We were blasting music. We were just having fun. So Frednik was always the Monday after Friedman. And so that was that. Then there was the night, you all remember when ER went live? They did the show live, ER, back on the show. Well, that night we decided to go live in the ER. Yeah. We pull back the curtain, and Dr. Pat Meadows, God love her, and Rich, you weren't here yet, okay? Pull back the curtain, we're in the middle of another 2-14 Falcons season, and Pat Meadows is giving the Falcons helmet CPR. Yeah. And we got the Falcons on life support, you know, it's live ER. Oh man, you know, that was a whole lot of fun, I remember that. But, you know, as you said, I had a chance to host a TV show. Rich said this, heading into my junior season. I remember meeting with Coach Corso, you know, and I said, you know, Coach, I've got a chance to do this. What do you think? He goes, you got to do the TV. I said, really, Coach? He goes, yeah, you can't play. I just hung my head. I said, but Coach, he goes, oh, Freddie, look at you, Freddie, look. He goes, you're small, you're slow, but you're good. I've seen you on TV. You're good. You can be good. So then, all right, that's my junior year. So then I'm walking to class. And if you see the big red Thunderbird, Tim McVay will back me up on this. If the big red Thunderbird comes by to pick you up on the way to class, you're going for a ride. Because you're going to get the one-on-one with Lee. So I'm in the car. Hey, listen, here's what we're going to do, okay? You're going to go up there. Don Tillman from Indianapolis is going to call you. And you better answer your damn phone. And when you talk to him, you're going to go up there, you're going to wear a suit, and you're going to do the best job you can. You're going to tell him you're going to do a hell of a job. sure enough. And he goes, and you know what else? Don't be late. Because you can never be late. Well, that job turned out to be the analyst on the Indiana football telecast. So, and then literally, I'm doing the Indiana football telecast that I auditioned for. And then, this is no lie, I am peeing at Ohio State during halftime. And the program director from the station block says, hey, our sports guy quit. You know how to anchor sports? And I'm like, sure, yeah, hell yeah, dude. And, you know. So on the plane back, we go back and I start to, and the director's there, and the director of the newscast in Indianapolis, all right? This guy was Cowboy Bob. He had the morning kids show. And he's hammered. I mean, hammered. So I'm coming in there at night, and this is the first time I'm going to anchor. Cowboy Bob's hammered. And he looks up at me and goes, who are you? I said, I'm going to be doing sports. Goes, well, I'll tell you what, pal, you're not going to be on camera much tonight because I, you know, I got to do all this crap myself. I don't know. I'm like, okay, cowboy, whatever. So we're just boom. So there goes the sports cast, and then, and that's how it went, you know, and we took off from there, and we would go and do games, and I'd come back, and that was really my senior year, was driving up to Indianapolis every weekend. My buddies are up partying, and I'm driving up working, so, you know, and that station was where I learned how to hot splice film. We had an anchor woman, Athel was her first name, I'll never forget this. Athel's going to teach me how to hot splice film, if everybody remembers that. With a cigarette in her mouth, hey, Freddie, come over here, I'm going to show you what to do. Okay, we're dealing with this clue, and she's got a lit cigarette. I'm thinking to myself, if we all blow up, they're going to blame it on the Lebanese kid, right? You know that. But anyway, as we said, we talked about, you know, the colloid cyst they dug out of my head, and that was a trip. You know, when you talk about Gary Brock, when he came in there and he saw me, he said, you know what, I know what it is, I know where it is, we'll get it, we'll be done. I'm like, you're going to saw my effing head open. He goes, yeah. He goes, I'm going to take a saw and run through your head this way, and I'm going to take a saw and run through your head that way. And I'm going to drill a hole in there, I'm going to get it. We're going to be done. It's going to be benign. You're going to be great. Sounds simple, right? Yeah, okay, sure. But I always talk about August 16th, as I said, as the day that Elvis died and I didn't. But that was the day of my brain surgery. But I really want to thank Mark Pimentel for giving me a chance to come back and be the main guy again. We worked together over 20 years ago. Our news director, Steve Dore, and Paul Karpowitz, my general manager in Indianapolis. Talk about how things come full circle. He's the president of Meredith. So that was a nice reference to have when you're going for a job. And all the photographers, the news producers, the co-workers over the years who've helped along the way, and to the Atlanta Press Club for this honor. I mean, I can't believe it. I'm in the Hall of Fame. I cannot believe it.